a room full of engineering teachers. What an opportunity. Mike has a particular interest in STEM education, and he's going to explore this very question here in his presentation. I understand he's got three parts to look at. Where are we at the moment? What could vet engineering offer STEM education, and how could this be implemented? That sound about right, Mike?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Right. Well,
at the time of submission.
Yes. Well, look, and that's right. I'm only acting on the buy side of the sea, which I believe to be true at the time.
Yeah.
If I've offended anyone, I regret it. You don't apologise, you just regret it. Okay? So, let's put our together and welcome Michael Brown.
Thank you.
Yeah, he's serious.
Yeah, he's got a jacket on. You want to hear what I know about carbon fibre?
No, all right.
We'll talk about STEM and vet engineering. And I was putting the 10 bucks in the parking meter, and I thought, what a bargain. Room full of vet engineering teachers, and I get to talk to them for 20 minutes or so. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Wonderful presentations from the researchers before me. Well done. Let me give you a piece of advice. Always team up with someone who's smarter than you. All right, so that's my question.
There we go.
STEM in sort of popular culture, and here's some movies and books where STEM is predominant. One of my latest favourite ones is The Martian, and how he's sort of an engineer and a botanist. The great story of John Harrison and how he was set out to solve the issue of longitude at sea. And I was driving here and I sort of go over the James Harrison Bridge. Did you see the James Harrison Bridge in Geelong? Now he's famous for something, is he? Didn't he invent something?
Refrigeration.
That's right. James Harrison, refrigeration. For double points. That's down there near sort of Belmont Comet. There used to be a guy who used to fly his plane in and sort of landed on Belmont Comet. He used to take aerial photos of Geelong. Very famous New Zealander. Anyone in the room at all? Anyone?
Charles Pratt?
Yes, Charles Pratt. Hold on. No, I learnt that off Karen's dad. All right, so let's see how we go. There you go. So, spare parts, a movie about some... hang on, my mum wants to talk. The kids who went into a competition with building a submersible. Been made into a movie as well. All right. So, look at this guy.
Oh.
This is Ben Engineering. This is well-known engineering. This is how they make those sort of rowing boats. You know boats? Yeah, it's made out of this special materials. Yeah. What's the name of the company?
John.
Sorry. And this guy, who's this guy? All right, he's a vet engineering student. I think he's at Whittlesea. And what about this one here? I know, a couple of kids having a bit of a go at making something. And very important with education to have this sort of active kind of learning. How are you going being on the other side? You know, like you're normally walking around the room and students are really active, and now you're like the injured football player who has to sit on the sideline and watch the team play. So just for this morning, it looks like you're on the other side of the fence today. Yeah, there we go. So this is one of my favourite teachers out there, Breakwater as well, out at G-Tech, that's Gavin. And this is one of his VCOL classes. This kid is obviously looking up Google to find some information on his phone. So this is his class, and the students are making this sort of slot car racing stuff. And so my question that I'm sort of asking is, What is the question being asked of which the answer is the vet engineering training package? What's the question of for which that is the answer? And I'm just wondering if we asked a different question, whether we might get a different answer. And so I'm wondering if vet engineering teachers, and I'll say this a bit later on, whether they're V8s running on six cylinders. And we'll sort of get to that as we progress. But I think this guy's been pretty creative in his classroom. He's got lots that he can do. He's got to find a project for the students to do. He's got to try and engage them. And so I'm interested in this vet in schools area, as well as the TAFE area. So as you know, vet is a compulsory part of two levels of VCAL. And here's some kids in schools up at Ballarat. That used to be the old Sebastian Tech. It's now
Phoenix College.
Phoenix, out of the ashes. Okay, good. All right. They didn't have any vet teachers. So they rang me up and said, I can have a couple down there. So in this room, there's five sort of trainee teachers working with those students. Anyone from Sunny Tafe?
No.
Yeah, come on. Are you?
Yeah.
And so you recognise this?
Mm-hmm.
I went up there in about 2012, just before the plague hit. You know, when the plague hit TAFE in May 2012. Well, before that, there was TAFE teachers doing lots of things, and Sunny TAFE was one of those places where they had the. Which campus are you on?
Yeah,
Mildura. So there was also Swan Hill, where they've got the pods that they make, and the apprentices making sort of high or low energy buildings, etc. So a lot of kind of experimentation and stuff going on that was extracurricular, but not that far removed from what they did. This is not in the course, correct? Not in the course. And so my experience of being a TAFE teacher was, I thought that in our staff room we had the staff that could put a bloody, certainly a monkey, but a person on the moon. I thought the collected expertise of the teachers that I worked with in the TAFE college I worked with could do so much. What I'm seeing in the training package is probably what industry wants, etc. I'm less convinced that it's ideal for what young people need in 5 and 10 years' time. I would say that Benton Schools is nothing like what young people need in 5 and 10 years' time. So why do we do it? All right, we do it. That's what the system is. But maybe the system is wrong. And what does engineering teachers have to offer in what might be a revamp? If we were to revamp these areas, would the vet engineering teachers have something to offer? All right, so STEM education. So what I've done here is I've ripped off slides from the VCAA. What's wrong with this diagram? This is the Victorian curriculum. This is their idea of STEM. STEM, science, technology, engineering and maths. That's four things. What's missing? What is missing? Are you telling me that you've got nothing to offer STEM education? Or are you telling me that you're seen to not be able to offer anything for STEM education? Why is that? Anyway, let's ignore this and move on. Where is engineering? Yeah, good question. And so one of the things about STEM education, inquiry-based, authentic problems to be solved, etc. So there's a whole raft of people that are starting to talk about developing entrepreneurial thinking, which isn't necessarily about making money, but it's about being sort of looking for things that are needed in the future and being innovative. And they talk about product-driven learning. Product-driven learning. These are some of the points about sort of STEM education. Is there anything here for you, or are you irrelevant? Well, I'd argue that the training packages are making you irrelevant to this type of education. Now, I might be totally wrong, might be being really, really harsh, but that's the picture that's being sort of built up for me. Now, I'm a troublemaker, I know that, but the argument then is vet in schools is really good at giving students an option who wouldn't normally make it to year 12. So it's a great option to get people to finish year 12 who wouldn't normally finish year 12. So let's call that retention. It's really good at retention. The number of students who complete that course and then go into that trade is so minimal, it's the most inefficient kind of program you can get. They're not going into those trades. There might be one a class or two a class at the most who are going into those areas. One of the things I've been looking at is one of the smallest study designs in VCE is one called systems engineering. I've been having a look at that and sort of wondering why it's so small. There's 800 students did it last year, of which 15 of them were female. And I think it's a wonderful course, and I just think that there could be other courses. But it's got the word engineering in it, so let's have a look at some of the things that go on. The future of work stuff is saying that STEM's sort of going to be involved in the future. It's saying that communication is going to be a big skill, more than technical skills. So is design skills are going to be important as well. Things that are non-routine can't be automated, are harder to automate. Yeah, I'm a researcher, I have to write all that stuff. Okay. This is jobs projected qualifications on projected jobs. Most of the new jobs are going to require a degree. That's the sort of what the thought is. The thought is that the job requirements are going up to degree level. So most of the new jobs are going to be there. There's a whole lot of stuff that costs people money, and the cost of leaving school or being disengaged costs heaps. And you heard Tim talk about people who drop out, etc. There's different outcomes. So this is why the year 12 thing's important. The outcomes, they have better outcomes in the labour market, they have better outcomes in earnings for their lifetime, better health and well-being, etc. Shorter periods of unemployment, providing you have year 12 completion. So this is a recent report on how much it costs society for an early school leaver annually and for the cohort over their lifetime. So that if you use this sort of costing, there should be money around to do stuff. Disengage people. All right, so this, of course, is the new acronym for Vet in Schools. So highly successful for retention, and we know that retention's important. Oh, who's this? Anyone know who this is? What's this got to do with STEM? No. Who's this? Anyone?
Crazy Bird.
Yeah.
All right. That's a 14-year-old girl called Lee. An Australian girl, and she's in training with rock climbing. Did I say what age?
20.
All right. So she's up there with that other. What was that other girl who sort of sailed around the world? What was her name? All right, she was 16 once, she, what she said. So, you know, young people, potentials. Where'd this photo, come from?
Ringwood.
Hey? Where was that?
Ringwood Training.
Ringwood Training Centre. All right. So this is in your workshop, David?
Yep, that's it.
And who do you teach?
Hey, we teach vet in school.
Yep.
And apprentice training as well.
Right. So if some bloody loudmouth academic come up to you and said, your course is crap, what would you say?
Yeah, probably is.
Probably.
No, we'd say, we've got a great course.
Yeah, of course, because you have to say that, right? If you wanted to have a fantastic course, would it be the same as what you teach now, or would it be very, very different?
It would be considerably different, yeah.
Do you think you'd be getting across engineering concepts in that new course?
Yeah.
Okay, so you could still do engineering, but it would be very different to what it is now, and you think it would be a really good course?
Yes.
What stops us?
Curriculum.
Courses. Auditing. You're not going to get far if you've got a bloody, not only do you have to swim between the flags, but there's a bloody, there's a vacuum cleaner that picks you up if you go outside the flags. This is Whittlesey, secondary. Can we improve senior secondary school programs? Can we, rather than be the veggie kids in VCAL, could it be the best course in the school? I reckon it could. And what stops it? Oh, it's not the lack of talent of teachers. Something else is stopping it. So, let's maybe sort of have a think about that. Are some of our current vetting schools engineering teaching V8s running on 6 cylinders?
Yep.
Now, are we in danger of someone dying in these classes, right? dying. They could pass away on us out of boredom. So the design and technology teachers are trying to be part of the conversation. They've been left out. So what is it about the other side of the school that the principals and the course writers don't go over there, or don't know what happens over there, or don't know the capabilities of the teachers that they've got? What is it about that stops people from having that sort of communication? Well, I don't know. This is the one-page, double-sided flyer for the new course for Bendigo Tech School. So there's 10 tech schools, right, that are being built, and so Karen here's a world tech school, and she rings them up and she says, we could be part of this as vet people. No, vet is not part of the tech school. Is that right? Is that what you were told?
That's what I understand, yeah.
That's what you were told. So what is this concept of a tech school that they're sort of running? So it's around STEM, and oh, that's STEM without an E, by the way. Oh, STEM without a T either. So let's call it S&M.
Where do you sign up?
Now you're interested. All right, okay. So really, it's capital S. Small T, small E, capital M. That's because you've got nothing to offer. You've got nothing that you do that's involved with science, technology, engineering, or maths. Nothing at all. I love the refrigeration trade, and I just know enough about it to be dangerous, with the changes of states and the physics and the pressure and the temperatures, etc. So I think of James Harrison. This is my trade, the sort of fabrication area, and talking about family support. Who was family support? Oh, my father was a sheet metal worker. My older brother was a sheet metal worker. I was a sheet metal worker. So, you know, that's how the family used to sort of run.
Team bashes.
I started my apprenticeship on my 15th birthday, and I was finished on my 19th. So, as a sheet metal worker. It's also Karen's trade, although she'd like it to be much thicker metal. And so, nothing to do with whatsoever. All right. And you try to tell people, you know, what do you do? Oh, I used to walk around the room and I used to say, oh, gee, to the apprentice, gee, your maths is really good. And I'd say, where's the maths? Because they're looking for the numbers. Well, let me tell you, those people over the other side of the school, they can't see the maths here either. So we have to point it out to them. Karen prepared these. Oh, Melbourne Polytechnic. Anyone from Heidelberg?
That's
where are you from?
Big Polytechnic.
So you're Sunshine?
Yeah.
Right.
Sunshine.
Yeah, how's that going?
That's terrific.
Is it?
Yeah. And the answer's 42. I know you're going to ask me a question, but the answer's 42.
Is there anything you'd like to say?
42.
Now, other than 42, is there anything you'd like to say about your area?
Yeah, it's terrific.
Is it? How long have you been doing it?
Since
1987. You have you? Yeah. And what area of engineering are you in?
Fitting machining, the only trade.
No maths there.
Oh, no.
No science there.
No Pythagoras or anything.
No, that's right. Did you ever work down at the other campus? You know, the one that's got engineering written on the brickwork? I'm trying to think, because you talk in streets, don't you, when you talk of campuses at Footscray?
Yeah, Footscray.
Yeah. The one near the shops. You know the one near the shops?
Nicholson Street.
Yeah. Nicholson Street.
Yeah, we worked there.
Did you?
Yeah.
And when the trains go past, you sort of shake a little?
Yeah, we used to wake the students up, it was good. Have you been one of those students?
Hey?
Having been one of those students, it could be annoying as well.
So you were a student there as well?
Yeah.
Oh, what a nightmare. So you got sent to the school as a teacher where you were a student?
No, I got a job there.
Yeah. Same thing happened to me. My first teaching job was Templestowe Tech. I was trying to stay there and they were trying to move me into TAFE. For my second year, and in those days we got paid full money to be a trainee, and they wanted to move me into TAFE, and I said, no, look, they're short here at Templestowe Tech, I'll stay here and take someone else into TAFE. And they said, and the guy said to me, you be here on Monday or you're nowhere. So I was there on Monday. So I was at the TAFE college where I went as a student, and I did night school there as well. I did English and maths and stuff at night. Technician maths, it was called, technician English. A funny looking shape thing. Another funny looking, this is Melbourne Polytechnic. Now, who's from Heidelberg?
Over this side.
And what's your area?
Fabrication.
Is it? How long have you been there?
20 years.
All right. I trained with Wayne. Do you know Wayne?
Yeah, I just re-employed Wayne.
Did you? Did you pass the interview?
Yeah. Wayne retired.
Retired! Oh, Christ.
Terrific,
yeah. Excellent. All right, so no science at all. Don't know what you're doing. Systems engineering, I'll be real quick. There's a kid from Forest Hills. He's simulated a lift. So he's made this plastic sort of PVC or Perspect lift. This is a motor out of a roller door. A circuit down here. He's got sensors so he can send it to whatever level he wants to. I said, why'd you make it out of plastic to see through? He says, because I wanted to get into top design. I wanted everyone to see how it worked. This kid, his dad's an engineer, he's out at St. Helena. And this is a robot vacuum cleaner. And his mum says, why he's making a vacuum cleaner, she's got no idea, because he wouldn't know how to use one.
So he turned it into a robot, so he doesn't.
Correct. Where do you work?
Swinburne.
Do you?
Yeah.
All right, I'll talk slow. I saw you with your motorbike helmet on yesterday.
Yeah.
So I used to go to class in John Street.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Started in John Street.
Did you?
Yeah. And I went to school there as well, so like you, I went back to TAFE where I went to school.
As an apprentice?
No.
Fully? As a secondary school?
Night classes.
Yes. Too many years there. Good. But Richard, I couldn't do the calculus. The calculus was the bloody, the brick wall that stops you going any further as a kind of an engineer. So I reckon it's hard to learn tonight.
That's right.
That's a bit rough. Yeah, all right. Well, I was a boy.
You obviously didn't have a good teacher.
It was hard to do 2 hours a week, I reckon. It was a big jump for 2 hours a week to bloody learn that stuff. Anyway, this kid, this is year 11. He's doing year 12 and year 11. Templestowe Secondary, every student's on an individualised plan. So they're all in together. So they can be year 7 kids in with year 12 kids. It's depending on what it is that they want to learn. So whether you want to read book 1 of Harry Potter or book 3, it depends which sort of class you go into. Anyway, this kid, you put your hand on here and this sort of works away. What impresses me is if it can hold a sort of a conical shape. Anyway, year 11, and Nathan got offered a spot at RMIT. Naturally, he said it's too far. you can't get across the young kids. Anyway, these are from Top Design, which is the exhibition that's held at the museum each year. There's 9 projects from each of the sort of technology areas, and the same schools come up year after year after year. Do you know why? Because it's the same teachers year after year after year. So Sydenham, a guy called Bruno out there, pure wanking engineer. This one where they're sort of the automatic goat feeder. Cardinia, just out the back here, the international school. Comes up every year as well. This is the stats on how many students do the subject. I won't worry about that too much, just at the moment. This is one of my favourites. I said, oh, can I come and interview you? She said, no. That was the end of that. But she black belt in karate, doing engineering at RMIT. But I love this project. You know, I love this project. Some of the kids do design technology and they do, you know, the prom dress and all this sort of stuff, you know, drives me nuts. This young woman, she wanted to do something that could be used in a developing country, and she sort of came up with this pump. So I went over it. And these are folio pages. They have to do a folio to go with it. This young woman, she's out at Deakin. I went and interviewed her, and her dad's an engineer. Same school comes up. There's usually about 3 people from this school in the top 9 students in the each year with this teacher. I said to him, how do you know how to do, you know, how do you swap from one project to another with each student? And he says, when they come to me, I don't know if it can be done. I have to learn about it like the student does. Sometimes I have to hose it down a bit so I can be done. But he's sort of saying it's open-ended. And I said, what did you originally do? He said, I was a maths teacher. I said, maths, and there's so much electronics. He said, maths and electronics are the same thing. Electronics just is, all it is maths. So it's interesting how people see the world, you know. Another submersible. Another feeder. I like the one where the dog comes up and puts the ball in and then it gets fed. You know, they're the ones I kind of like. Anyway, you got the idea, right? Yeah. And this is stuff that I feel compelled to put in as an educator. Project-based learning, inquiring projects. Maybe there's something there. And I'm sort of saying that maybe it should be called Imagineering. A name that's sort of been used elsewhere sometimes in different ways. And we all have to learn, and this guy with the bald head, that's been doing electronics one Saturday with the teachers out at Diamond Valley. This guy's from Dramana, he's from Glen Waverley. And when I get to this, this is the Sculptor Park at Werribee. I walk around the Sculptor Park with my daughter, you know, and I think, oh, what the hell does this mean? You know? And I don't get it till I sort of see a little bit and I just read this one or two sentences about it, you know, and I'm sort of looking at that. What the hell is this one all about? It says, it's called Happy Ending. All right, so I reckon I've got to the end, but I need a couple of quick comments. And people from Swinburne are usually the smartest ones, so I just thought, you'd like to just comment on in regards to some of these issues that I've tried to overview today.
Obviously what we've seen is what you would consider to be the best case scenario of a student with these projects that they've shown on there. Have you got some sort of an example where you could show me how a low achieving student, as burgers or something like that?
So your issue is that there's a range of students in your class and you don't have the sort of students that would be able to do this sort of work. Is that where you're kind of asking the question about that? And I would say it's irrelevant. I would say that the thing that we're trying to get across is a process to students, a process of designing and researching and putting ideas together and then making it. And so it's not going into Bunnings and buying the plans for the outdoor furniture, it's knowing why the outdoor furniture is that high, etc. So it's kind of a lot to it. So that's a fair comment. Not everyone's going to be able to. These are the top students. What about behind? Any comments that you'd like to make? Hey, the other Swinburne guy. No, where were you? Heidelberg. Yeah, what do you think?
Well, in my experience with general schools is that we're in an area that, what I will say is the teachers don't, the staff have a different perspective of those students to apprentices. Good and simple because they aren't the high achievers in the secondary schools, they're the low achievers, and they don't get respect of the staff, but they do the staff in the apprentices because of their lack of skills and their lack of monitoring in some most cases.
Yes. But if I was coming in to do that bloody training package as a better school student, I wouldn't want to bloody work either. You've got to be motivated and all that. Now listen, you make the students redo the course anyway when they come in with their better school's qualification. Think about what that qualification is and maybe it can be a bit different. So, good point. Thank you.
My concern is that you've got the better, you've got all of that type of education going on, and looking at current technology, what I think is that once they then come into that, we're back in the 19th century, right? We're not progressing to that automated requirement, we're not progressing to Industry 4, we're heading into Industry 5, yet we're just starting to wake up about Industry 4.
Yeah, good point. What about you, Shorty? You got anything you want to?
Sure.
Can you catch a basketball?
Yes.
What's a basketball?
Football. Look, you're right with everything. Everything, obviously, being project-based, project-driven is going to engage students a lot more, but there's a lot of restrictions with the current training package.
Yes. And it's not your call. The training package isn't your call.
There is some scope to be able to incorporate projects in their second year subjects, but even the subjects we get to choose from doesn't in the evidence we have to collect for every unit now, like the training program, the trailer I've done before, all project-based delivery, we need to collect evidence for that to satisfy the units of competency, and that's where we're getting confused with this.
Yes.
Yeah, well, you're on the right track in regards to what is going to engage the younger students better, but what we as RTOs can do, we're not compliant if we do that.
So I reckon there's a bit of a mismatch on what young people possibly need and what's being provided.
100%. And what's being allowed. Again, you're right, the teachers and the staff have the capability and the knowledge to be able to do these projects, but they're being restricted and held back.
Mate, if you deviate, I've got the audit over here to drag you back. And do you know what? Do you know what some, no, I know it's not in your courses, but in some vet courses, they've now become not what's good teaching and learning, but how can we produce the minimum evidence we need to pass the audit? Now, you did not hear that from me. These are the issues that are kind of above all of our pay grades. But shit, if we don't talk about them at the annual conference, I don't know when we do talk about them. All right. Listen, thanks for the opportunity to come along. Where's me wine? Right.
The students aren't always engaged. I'm sure the delegates here have been engaged by Mike's presentation, and there is something for you.
Oh.
And it's conical. So, my worst enemy was